Bienvenidos, welcome. Hello everybody. My name is Ignacio Ugarte and I'm the president of ECUSA, the association of Spanish scientists in the US. I'll tell you something about that later on, but I just wanted to give you the welcome to this event. It's great to see you here, full room to talk about science, technology, innovation, Spain, the US. It's great, this is great. We have a very complete program. We have two sections. The first part is going to be more in the direction of the science. We're going to have the presentation of ECUSA, the ECUSA California. We're going to have a talk by an invited speaker. And then we are going to have a panel discussion where we bring in the industry. And without further ado, I'm just going to introduce the welcome remarks. And we are going to have first Marina del Corral Tellez, who is Secretary General of Immigration and Emigration.
Es para mí un placer estar aquí esta tarde con todos vosotros. Estoy aquí en representación de la Ministra de Empleo y Seguridad Social. Es ella quien debería estar aquí. Y creedme que lo siente muchísimo el no estar y cuando le cuente además pues todas las experiencias que habéis compartido conmigo lo va a sentir más. Agradezco muchísimo la invitación de ECUSA, de Ignacio Ugarte, también de la Cámara de Comercio California-España, porque son los que han organizado este evento. Para que todo el mundo lo entienda, el papel del Gobierno de España, en concreto de la Secretaría General de Inmigración y Emigración, de la que soy titular, que forma parte del Ministerio de Empleo y Seguridad Social, nuestro papel es simplemente financiar a determinadas entidades para que ejecuten determinados programas a favor de los jóvenes que están jóvenes españoles que están residiendo en el exterior. Y esto es lo que ha hecho de manera brillante la Cámara de Comercio, junto, bueno, con el apoyo de muchos de los presentes y creo que con bastante éxito por lo que he podido escuchar esta tarde. Yo creo que el objeto de por qué está alguien de vosotros, María, me preguntaba antes cuando nos hemos presentado, es una de las participantes, de las beneficiarias del programa, me ha preguntado qué política estábamos haciendo, qué cambios estábamos haciendo desde el gobierno para a favor de los jóvenes, porque en todas partes leemos que hay muchos residentes españoles nuevos en el exterior. Bueno, yo no voy a entrar en las cifras, antes he intentado explicarlo y no voy a estar, ese no es el tema esta tarde, pero sí que le he dicho que efectivamente hay un cambio que queremos transmitir y que forma parte, en definitiva, de las políticas de empleo que están, todas las reformas estructurales que se están abordando desde el Ministerio de Empleo y Seguridad Social. En concreto, estábamos hablando, y es el tema de estas jornadas, este seminario, estábamos hablando de uno de los problemas que presentaba nuestro sistema en España, es que no estaba prevista de ninguna manera la transición desde el término de la formación a la entrada a formar parte de una organización empresarial, de una industria. No estaba previsto. Y eso es una de las cuestiones que se han abordado dentro de la reforma laboral del Ministerio de Empleo. Lo han oído todos, se han hecho reformas, insisto, estructurales, que entendemos que van a producir, que ya lo están produciendo, efectos muy positivos en el mercado laboral español, y que creemos que son más sólidos y que permitirán pues soportar una crisis en el caso de que se vuelva a producir de una manera más, ligera, más preparados que en otras ocasiones. España ha sido uno de los países más afectados por la crisis y la crisis ha afectado a todo el mundo. ¿Y por qué más a España? Pues nosotros hemos considerado que precisamente era porque teníamos unos problemas estructurales que abordar. Y entonces hemos aportado más flexibilidad al mercado laboral, hemos procurado abordar este problema de la transición entre la formación y el empleo, hemos incluido la propia formación, dentro de la propia formación, pues el tener una formación práctica, y eso es importante también en el momento de la empleabilidad. Y en definitiva lo que consideramos es que la empleabilidad es lo más importante y cualquier inversión en formación es fundamental. Creemos en eso como creemos que todo lo que sea formación es una inversión que confiere un valor añadido a cualquier persona. Necesitamos capital humano y necesitamos capital humano preparado. Sois hoy aquí en esta sala, bueno, hay tanto talento que yo me siento pequeñísima. Estoy encantada de estar con todos vosotros, pero es importante que sepáis que tenéis un valor. Bueno, no sé si lo sabéis, yo creo que no, porque los españoles solemos no apreciarnos nada, pero tenéis un valor muy grande y lo que sí es importante que conozcáis es que desde el gobierno lo conocemos, lo sabemos, que tenéis ese valor, sois un activo muy importante y egoístamente estamos dispuestos a invertir en vosotros porque consideramos que estéis aquí o estéis en España, si regresáis, desde luego siempre habrá una alfombra roja, trabajamos para que las condiciones pues sean las mejores para que podáis llegar, creemos en la innovación, creemos en la tecnología, creemos que tenemos que adaptarnos a ese dinamismo que hoy impera en los mercados y necesitamos gente preparada, gente que contribuya al sistema, al sostenimiento del sistema del estado de bienestar. Y bueno, vosotros sois unos ejemplos fundamentales para la administración española y desde luego el programa este, gracias a la brillante implementación y a la ayuda de sponsors que también están aquí hoy presentes, pues podemos hacer la realidad de la transición, facilitar la transición de algunos profesionales brillantísimos entre la formación y la introducción en el mercado laboral. Yo creo que contribuir a ese desarrollo profesional es lo mejor que puede hacer un país. Y por favor, no perdáis nunca los vínculos con España. La transferencia de conocimiento no conoce fronteras. El conocimiento no conoce ninguna frontera. Yo me ocupo de los temas migratorios en España y desde luego a nadie eso no es un problema. Para atravesar las fronteras. Tenemos que abrazar las tecnologías, tenemos que adaptarnos a esa innovación. Si no lo hacemos, perderemos competitividad. Yo os animo a todos a seguir invirtiendo en vosotros mismos, a creeros que valéis muchísimo, que lo estáis haciendo muy bien y sobre todo que penséis que sois visibles. Habéis venido todos aquí silenciosamente con vuestro apoyo familiar o con vuestra beca, pero silenciosamente. Y creo que es hora de que os hagáis visible, de que España apueste por el conocimiento y creo que vosotros sois esos embajadores y esos protagonistas. Entonces, os agradezco mucho la presencia y no tengo nada más que decir porque hay mucho que decir y mucha gente a la que oír, mucho talento a quien escuchar.
All right, next in line, we have with us the general director, the FECID, the Spanish Foundation for Science and Technology, José Ignacio Fernández.
Thank you. Secretaria General, profesor Fuster, profesor de Lecea, doctor Ugarte, buenas tardes a todos. Para mí es un placer estar aquí. Yo quiero ser muy breve y tengo solo tres mensajes que decir. El primero, que tengo que dar las gracias a la Consejería de Empleo, tengo que dar las gracias a la Cámara de Comercio y tengo que dar las gracias a ECUSA por estar esta tarde aquí. Muchas gracias a todos por haberme invitado. El otro mensaje que tengo que dar es de ánimo. Yo creo que el trabajo que está desarrollando ECUSA y el ejemplo que está dando esta tarde aquí, todo el esfuerzo de Luis y del resto de las personas que han estado trabajando aquí, demuestra que existe realmente un interés en establecer lazos o enlaces de unión en el conocimiento entre personas que, siendo del mundo científico, del mundo tecnológico, quieren mejorar su capacidad de relación. ¿Por qué es bueno? Porque es bueno encontrarse dentro de una empresa global llamada ciencia, que lo lleva siendo muchos años, y el tercer mensaje, y muy breve, es que esta empresa global llamada ciencia se conecta en este sitio en concreto con la empresa, con el sector del conocimiento que permite un desarrollo económico mayor. Solamente hay tres vectores de transferencia tecnológica. Uno, los trabajos realizados para el desarrollo de proyectos de investigación. Eso es minoritario. Las patentes. Eso es minoritario. Y sobre todo en España. Otro, la venta de material de equipo de alta tecnología. Bueno, eso es un porcentaje alto. Y finalmente, la que es aplastante, es la transferencia tecnológica que se produce a través de las personas. De las personas con formación, con ánimo y con capacidad de cambiar el objetivo y de cambiar el ámbito del desarrollo del conocimiento y el desarrollo económico. Y por eso os animo a seguir trabajando, y desde la Fundación Española para la Ciencia y Tecnología estaremos con vosotros en aquellas condiciones, en aquellas circunstancias que vosotros lo consideréis. Muchas gracias.
What is ECUSA? ECUSA is an acronym that stands for Españoles Científicos en USA, Spanish Scientists in the US. ECUSA is a young organization. We started last year, 2014, March last year, we were 9 people. We had an idea, I'm sure we weren't the only ones, but it just went through. And we're very proud to say that today we have 500 members, and distributed all over the country. We have people in 30 states. We are starting, but we're very proud of that. We have 900 subscribers in our newsletter that goes out every 2 weeks with our news. And what I really like the most of the initiative is that there are 50 professionals, science professionals, because that's what we are. We are not only researchers, this is professionals of science, that are devoting time and energy to run it, to develop the programs, to accomplish the objectives of the association. And so what are the objectives of the association? That's what you want to know. What is this about? Well, the way we think about this is threefold. We are a community of professionals, professionals of science, and for that reason, what we want to do is to enrich, strengthen, and promote that the careers of those professionals. We want to do that. We want to do workshops. We want to do events, synergies between us, like an event like this, where we meet science, industry. Because we have to get to know each other. We all of us have been in the country and maybe not known that many of us in the field or in different disciplines. So that's a way to create a network of support. But that's not the only one thing we want to do. That's what a professional association does. We have our looks also elsewhere. We want to look at the community, right? A society. We feel a responsibility to give something back to that society. And we feel that we need to educate, we need to do public outreach, we have to tell them why it's important what we do, right? And that's another of the objectives of the association. And the final objective of the association is that we are a group of people, professionals, that we have some interest. And I think we can put a voice, we can put a face, we can, whatever it is, I'm not going to tell what that is, but as a group, we can decide what it is, and then just have that conversation with other groups, public, private institutions, and tell them what we think about different things, about our expertise, because we have an expertise. We are professionals and very qualified. A lot of you guys that are here. So these are the main objectives, because what we want to do is that science, innovation, technology is in society, in the US society, and we know, I mean, we are at Stanford, right? And also in Spain, because many of us probably would come from Spain. We have studied there, degrees, PhDs, or anyway, we have some affinity. what have we done to accomplish some of these goals? Well, we have several programs. We obviously only have 1 year of existence, but we have a ciclo de conferencias. We have a seminar program that we have developed this year. And Fundación Ramón Areces, which is one of the sponsors, and I want to thank, together with FECID, who have supported us from the start. We have done 20 talks in 3 different cities, Washington, D.C., Boston, New York, with renowned scientists in the country, and today we have one in California. So this is great. We can do that. We can tell what we do to the community. We had a program of mentorship. We have in collaboration with several universities in Spain, where people like you were just in contact with students at Spanish universities and just doing mentorship, just that transfer of knowledge, and we are going to diversify that program in the future. Science in the schools, we want to bring the science to the schools, Spanish-speaking schools in the country, there are here. So those are some of the ideas. And just not to get long, I would say that the next program that ECUSA is going to do is in this room. Somebody has it here, in this room right now. And why do I say that, Isabeth? Because that has happened, because it happened in Boston, and because it happened in New York. And I'm sure it's going to happen here in Stanford. So this is a platform for people to find a place, meet new people, and develop ideas. It's not about telling you what you have to do. I mean, we need the help. We just want you to participate. I'm just looking forward to hear, Luis, what ECUSA California has to offer here. I mean, I'm excited because it's a great group, and I'm just looking forward to hearing you.
Yeah, thank you, everyone. In the interest of time, I'm just going to introduce myself. My name is Luis Talasea. I'm leading this chapter of ECUSA in California. And I'd like to, again, welcome you to Stanford. And I'd like to welcome you to register in our website. There's one email address, California at ECUSA.es. And you can register there, and there'll be many programs forthcoming. We plan a survey in the community to basically ask the community what do you want, what kind of activities you want, from all aspects, from professional development to workshops like this, to partnerships with industry and whatnot. So. Again, without further ado, I'd like to introduce our first speaker, Professor Joaquin Fuster, who is a real psychiatrist, not like me. I think he's probably the best choice for the first speaker of ECUSA California. He's definitely a pioneer among California residents. He obtained his medical degree in Barcelona in 1957. And he crossed the Atlantic by boat. So he established himself in LA, and he's been there since. Dr. Fuster is renowned for his seminal contributions in cognitive neuroscience. He's the author of a textbook on the cerebral cortex. He's been really leading the effort on memory cells and on so many aspects of cognitive neuroscience. I'm very honored and I'm proud of welcoming, and please join me in welcoming him.
They say that one day the Pope convened the conclave of cardinals, all of them, Monday morning. I have very interesting, important news for you. I have some good news and bad. The good news is that I received a call from God and everybody. Oh. They say the bad news is the call came from Salt Lake City. Now, I can assure you that these calls do not come from Salt Lake City. Then I wish to thank the organizers of this meeting for their invitation. I wish to thank, in particular, the representatives of the government of Spain, your president. I wish to thank the members of the ECUSA, those present, and those who are not present, for inviting me to this talk, and I will commence with the first slide here. Could you turn the lights off, the upper lights? In this presentation, I wish to cover four subjects very briefly. One is to give you my personal view of Western science, science in the West Coast, with its peculiarities, and it does have peculiarities. Number two, I wish to give you my experience with science in the West and give you a few highlights of my scientific work that I think support that view. Finally, I'll end up with a brief comment of our legacy, my wife and I, to the University of California, which where I have been for so many years. Now, this talk begins right here at Stanford. Once upon a while, a time, Cleveland Stanford and Jane Stanford were taking a trip through Italy. When they got to Florence, well, their son, their only son, was with them. When they got to Florence, the son was became very ill and died. Besides the devastation for them, for the couple, there was the consideration of what would they do with that fortune that they had. And they decided that it would be nice to have a university in their own estate. So was born the idea of Stanford Junior University at that time. Now, a university in this part of the country was at the time, yeah, sure, there was the UC system already beginning, but it was not that common at the time. The university was unheard of. So the search of the first president of the university was quite an odyssey. They had their emissaries, that is, the Stanfords had their emissaries in the East Coast, in all of the Ivy League universities. Two of the emissaries were the brothers Miller, the brothers James, sorry, William James and Henry James, the writer and the psychologist and philosopher. And they would call back, you can't find anybody. Nobody wants to come as a president in Indian country. So there was no way. Finally, after a long search, they found somebody in Indiana. And they told the Stanfords, he's a little peculiar, but I think you'll like him. And so, in the absence of anything better, he chose this man. David Starr Jordan, I think, is critical for the development of science in the Western United States. tall man, 6'2". His specialty was ichthyology, which means the study of fish. And of course, he was a devout of evolution. Now, he was, other than that, a mountaineer. He was one of the first Americans to climb the Matterhorn. And he was an ecologist at heart. And a charter member of the Sierra Club, one of the founders. He loved students. He liked camaraderie with the students, taking them on outings and so forth. And in 1891, he came on a train in Menlo Park, right here in the neighborhood, from Indiana, with a contract for $10,000 a year, which was a lot more than what here in Indiana. This is Jordan Hall, about half a kilometer from here. And on top are his two mentors and inspirers. One was Agassiz, a naturalist from Switzerland. The other one, famous geographer and naturalist, Alexander von Humboldt. Now, the spirit he brought to Stanford was what some have called, and I think he himself called it, enlightened individualism. Strange term. As a background, here's the sentence he pronounced on his inauguration: not be the slave of the past. But then, there was some comment from his old professor, White, at Cornell, who said, yet he is not with blessed good sense. In essence, what enlightened individualism is an interesting mixture of Anglo-Saxon Puritanism from the East and the spirit, the adventure spirit, the frontier of the West. I'll tell you, this spirit, which he brought, permeates all the Western universities and institutions from Vancouver to the Mexican border. What does that mean, really, enlightened individualism? It means do what you want and do it well with the utmost scientific rigor. And after you've done it, avail yourself to the others so that they can do their thing, which may not be the same thing as you, so that they can do their thing with their own initiative. Above all, create, dream, innovate. So that spirit, as I was telling you, can be found in all academic institutions and in industry of the West Coast. Remember, we're two graduate students. Here in this university, Page and Brin, two graduate students who invented and developed Google, right here, following that spirit of innovation and creativity that that man many years ago had brought to this West Coast. Now, enthusiasm, sponsorship and mentorship, intellectual freedom, and hospitable environment. You'll say, this is true of science everywhere. Yes, it is true of science everywhere. But those in yellow are particularly strong in the West Coast. I venture, there is a bit of conflict with a hierarchical thinking and organization of Eastern institutions and European institutions. These two principles right here are those that drive the young, good investigators in the West Coast and the good technological experts in the West Coast, all over. This does not mean that in the East Coast and in Europe, they don't have it. They do have it, but less. Now, I noted number two, sponsorship and mentorship. Critical, very important for the formation of a young person, a young scientist. Now I'll begin with my first sponsor, my father, the best teacher of psychiatry I've ever had. He was the chairman of psychiatry in the Universidad Autónoma de Barcelona. The other sponsor, the other mentor, sometimes has the same thing. Could you still lower the lights a little bit, if you please, or is that possible? Because I think that these things, that's better. Thank you. The other man who had a great influence on my life was Horace Magoon. Dr. Magoon was professor of anatomy in Los Angeles. And he was the discoverer of the reticular activating system. This is actually the reticular formation of the brainstem, which is very important for the transition from sleep to wakefulness, the arousal system, if you wish. Now, of course, we've learned a lot since then. We know the number of important chemicals that they didn't know at that time, amongst them were and mystine. So, but the principle was fascinating, still valid. In general, that system is very important for the transition from sleep to wakefulness. At the time when I was reading English, I mean learning English and reading physiology, I got in touch with Magoon from the city of Innsbruck, Austria, where I was learning some psychiatry. Now, this is the letter which I'm ashamed to show, but the English is atrocious, but quite convinced of the importance of the role of the brainstem reticular formations in the psychological and somatic manifestations in the circular sick, that means bipolar, mental diseases, I would be interested in undertaking some investigation work in order to study the function of those reticular formations in the maniac, literally, not manic, read manic, and melancholic, meaning repressed, states. Would it be possible, for instance, to measure with oscillography the latency, the speed, and other characteristics of the EEG arousal response in both kinds of patients? Could I work here under your direction, UCLA, that man? This was, I mean, if I received this letter, I don't know. Here is the polite answer of Professor Magoon. The program of investigation, dear Dr. Fuster, the program of investigation underway in Los Angeles is almost completely on the electrical activity of the brain in experimental animals. However, many aspects of the work are of interest for psychiatry. Should you be interested in devoting a year to this kind of activity, we should be happy to have you with us. Very sincerely yours, H.W. Magoon, Professor and Chairman. That year converted itself into 57. Why? Because at the time, remember, these were the 50s, in Spain, there was nothing doing in that type of thing. All right, and the first one to tell me to go was my father. You have nothing doing here if you're interested in the brain, go, which I did. Now, and of course, I looked for some support. Now, the support was necessary for the money part. Now, you saw the four principles, and money was not there. What happens is that money somehow shows up if you follow the other four, you see, even in times of crisis. So my support was indirectly from this man. This man was Gregorio del Amo. Gregorio del Amo nació en Santoña, in Cantabria. And he was a physician. He was formed in Madrid at the University of Complutense, I believe. Then he immigrated to the Americas. He came to South America and he practiced medicine in the Argentine and in Mexico. Eventually he was not all satisfied and he traveled to California. He came to California in the 1800s. He came here and continued practicing medicine. And at one time, Don Diego fue predecesor de usted. He was the consul general of Spain in San Francisco. He then married a lady of great wealth who possessed or whose father possessed the Rancho Dominguez. Manuel Dominguez was her father. And that was a small ranch within a much larger ranch that the family also owned, which was called the Rancho San Pedro. It happens to be the bottom half of the entire metropolitan area of Los Angeles. Huge, just huge, gigantic. It just so happens that in the 20s, 10 or 20s, oil was discovered on Signal Hill, right on their property. So the oil was gushing and they became very, very wealthy, very rich. Now, he never forgot medicine. He kept thinking of medicine, but the obligations of the business, they created the Del Amo estate and all, and they developed an enormous interest in philanthropy, especially to help physicians, doctors. So they instituted the Del Amo Foundation. The Del Amo Foundation was destined precisely to provide fellowships, becas, for students from Spain to come to California. And especially to two universities, UCLA and USC, and American and Californians to go to Spain to study for some time. All right, so I got my fellowship. This is the house of the Dominguez. It was an adobe, but somehow it was painted over and everything. And this is kind of dark, I don't know. It's, why did you need? it's still extant. It's a wonderful place to visit, actually. So I came to Professor Mahoon's place. That was the medical school at its beginning, or near its beginning, in 1954. When I came here in 56, it had three floors only. Now it has 10, 8 to 10. It's the largest building in floor space in the United States. Yes, ladies and gentlemen, we surpassed the Pentagon about 2 or 3 years ago when they built the Ronald Reagan Hospital. Anyhow, so I came. My fellowship was not very generous, but anyhow, I managed to get myself a little car, an old Pontiac, and actually, it's an interesting, that I rented the room in the house of a professor of geography at UCLA, $50 a day, a month, breakfast included. So, and here's myself in 57 in the Sierras. Oh, you can't see it, but I'm dreaming, supposedly. I'm dreaming of how am I going to stimulate that particular formation of the brain and demonstrate some effects on cognitive function, in particular attention, which was a function which is very much altered in psychiatric patients. So I constructed the tachistoscope, which was used for humans, but I could, with hammer and nails, actually. I constructed it myself for monkeys. So here a monkey is placed in front of a screen. A little object is shown, a cone or a pyramid in front of the monkey, and the light upon the object is lit for a few milliseconds. And the monkey must decide, it's the cone, or it's the pyramid, or something. So he looks only one side, and if he does make the right choice, that is the cone, he gets a piece of apple underneath. Quite primitive, but it worked. It had a timer, a tachistoscope, everything, and it worked very nicely. So the next question is, how do we implant electrodes in that particular formation of that monkey so that we could show some effects on attention? Now, here is where one of the important elements of enlightened individualism comes from. The help I got was enormous, not just money. I mean, everything, facilities, help. This is just a partial list. You know, the neuropharmacologist who taught me how to operate on an animal. There were no monkeys in there at all. The monkeys I got from somebody who bought, from Professor Lindsley, who bought them for me. Sawyer, anatomist, psychiatrist, who gave me a research job in the Department of Psychiatry because I had a psychiatric education. Then Livingston, a physiologist, head of neuroscience at San Diego, Bernice Wenzel, Jay McGee, etc. It was enormous. It's an outpouring of help from every corner. And I assure you that I was overwhelmed by it, but I made the best use I could of it. And eventually I managed to show that by stimulating the reticular formation in the monkey performing the task, the monkey saw better at shorter periods of time and the reaction time went faster. Indeed, there was a facilitation of attention. Now, if the current was above 300 microamperes, then everything went to pot. That was bad. But with 100 microamperes or so, I could get this facilitation. And sure enough, this was published a year and a half after I got there in Science, my first paper in Science, which of course delighted me and helped me a lot in getting further support and financial help from National Institutes of Health, etc. Now, then I spent 2 years at the Max Planck Institute. At that time, there was a rule instituted by Eisenhower that people who were here on so-called J visa, which I had, were supposed to leave the country for at least 2 years, go and then come back. So here comes UCLA, who maintains my research appointment, pays me every month, and I'm going to the Max Planck Institute in Germany with my good friend Otto Kreutzfeldt, and refine or learn actually my recording methods. There, by the way, we were the first to record intracellularly from the brain, from cells in the brain, from neurons. Of course, Eccles and others have done it in the spinal cord, you know, in the brain. That was in the visual system of the brain. In cats and rabbits, by the way. Then, a little while later, I discovered memory cells. These are the memory cells. Now, the sticks mean action potentials of one cell only, the whole picture. Now, there's a period when a cue is shown to an animal, to a monkey, and then a period of delay, of wait, which could be as long as half a minute. After the delay, the monkey is given a choice. If he chooses the right object that he saw, he gets a reward. If he doesn't, he doesn't get any more. These are rewarded trials, 5 of them. The last one with a very long delay. During the period of delay, the cell fires in a steady fashion. Why? Because the cell is engaged in what we call working memory. Alright, so these were the first working memory cells ever found. Now, later, of course, exploring other parts of the cortex and of the brain, we discovered memory cells in many, many different places, including in visual areas. For instance, here, a monkey, which you can barely see up on there, on top, is shown a color on a spot. Then a period of delay ensues, and at the end of the trial, 2 buttons light up, green and red. If he presses the button of the one that was, he gets rewarded. If he does not, then the trial ends and has to wait for the next trial. So this cell, all of the lines, the rows, are trials. Now, on top, the 5 or 6 or 7, on top are trials in which the light is red that needs to be remembered. Those in the bottom, when the light is green, that needs to be remembered. Notice that the cell is very much activated during the waiting period, during the working memory period of the red cue, not the green cue. And notice something else very important. As soon as the trial is over, even though in that period he has to foveate again the red, activity goes back to baseline, to normal. So it's quite specific. Now, as we will see, those cells I showed before were in prefrontal cortex. These are in infratemporal, visual cortex. So as we will see later, the two work in tandem together for the retention of information. Now, intellectual freedom. A colleague of mine, Phil May, and I asked ourselves, why woodpeckers don't have headaches? Well, how do you know? I mean, because if they had headaches, they wouldn't be pecking and hammering on wood like that. Sure enough, but there must be something in the structure of these beasts and all. So we got to study that kind of thing. Yes, we did. And in fact, we succeeded in having this published in The Lancet, which is the foremost medical journal in the UK. So the woodpecker, this was quite a story because we talked about the different helmets and how they, but no, the bottom line is this, that at the bottom of the bill, the beak, the woodpecker has spongy bone that acts as a shock absorber for the 3 or 4 or 5 G's of the impact, all right? Then the skull is so structured, it has a crest in the middle, inside, so that transmits the lines of force from the beak to the back, diverting the brain, or rather, surrounding the brain. It's built like a Gothic cathedral, you understand? So that was part of the thing. And the other thing is that it was very tightly packed, of course. We consulted with the Postmaster General and said, of course, it must be packed. None of those liquids in there. It'll be very packed for it, probably not to be injured. And then another thing that we discovered and we published in the Annals of Neurology was that when it pecks the animal with high-speed film, we did that. We got some collaboration from Walt Disney, you know, with the woodpecker. But then also we found a rancher in Placerita Canyon that had a woodpecker as a pet. And he had a little trunk there, and whenever the little beast heard a typewriter, he started pecking. It was so funny. Well, anyway, we took high-speed pictures, and the interesting thing is, they don't peck like this. No. They peck like this, which involves an enormous coordination of neck muscles. And of course, the reason is obvious. By doing this, they avoid the shearing forces and centrifugal forces inside the brain, you see. So they don't get the kind of injuries that boxers they get. Well, anyway, it was a little aside. But really, my overriding interest ever since the discovery of the memory cells was the prefrontal cortex, which I studied for some 30, 40 years. Now, I told you about the third edition. The first was in 1980, and now this month, I only have the cover, I'm sorry. Is coming the fifth edition to 2015. It used to be like this, now it's like that. So let me now go a bit into matters that may interest the technological crowd. The prefrontal cortex is one of the parts of the brain that grows the most in the course of evolution. It grows as evolution progresses, and it reaches as much as almost one-third of the totality of the cortex in the human, which is a lot of prefrontal cortex, a lot of cortex. Now, what are its functions? The main functions, I would say, of the prefrontal cortex, particularly the part of the convexity, the main function is the organization of new aim-directed sequences of behavior or language. The organization, the temporal organization of new sequences, goal-directed, of language or behavior. Now, in order to do that, it needs to certain cognitive functions, which we call executive functions. Amongst them is planning, working memory, decision-making, of course, attentional set, etc. But the most important thing which I'd like to point to you here is that the prefrontal cortex is in command and at the top of the perception action cycle. Now, what is this? The perception action cycle is a very, very old principle, biological principle of adaptation of the individual or the animal to the environment. It is the cybernetic cycle that links and adapts the organism to its environment in the course of behavioral language and reasoning. A percept, something from the outside comes in, is analyzed in the cortex through all its memory and knowledge networks. And that informs the action. That action produces an effect on the environment. That effect, in turn, produces new sensory input, which is analyzed and informs the next act, all of that toward a goal. So there is a lot of integration in time that is required. There are perception action cycles at very low levels of the nervous system, in the hypothalamus, for instance. They are middle level perception action cycles. The highest are in the neocortex, and those are presided by the prefrontal cortex. Now, it has two important peculiarities. One is that the prefrontal cortex is in charge of new cross-temporal contingencies, new sequences of behavior. And the other one, that's very important, is that it can predict the future. It can predict what's going to happen. It can predict what action will be needed. It can prepare for it. This pre-adaptation is fundamental. Now, of course, the most elementary perception action cycles can be found in all automated systems and robots. Sure. This is a picture of Robert Ballard, whom I knew because I had also a grant from the Office of Naval Research. This is the man who discovered the remains of the Titanic. Now, they gave us a grant because at that time we were studying tactile systems. And they needed sensors for tactile systems. 5 minutes, muy bien. Okay, I'll rush. All right, so the perception action cycle with all of these serving functions. And we can see that by a series of experiments in the monkey, that depending on the type of memory that needs to be retained in working memory, whether it's visual or it's auditory or tactile or spatial, there is a region of prefrontal cortex activated, and together with it, a region that is specialized in the modality of the stimulus that is to be remembered, that is to be retained. And this principle, and these principles, I would say, operate not just in the animal, but also in the human. Here is a delayed matching to sample task for humans. Here, the human is presented with a face. Then he must retain, or she retain, that face for a period of delay of some 20 seconds. Then two faces appear, and the subject is supposed to say, it's this one, or it's that the other one. So it's working memory for faces. All right. In human subjects, and this is a meta-analysis of several studies, what we see is the following. This is the waiting period before the stimulus is presented. Here the stimulus visually is presented, the face. You can see an activation of visual cortex and infratemporal cortex, and at the same time of prefrontal cortex. That is the perception action cycle at work in working memory. Then at the end of the delay, the two faces will appear, And then visual, of course, will be lit, and in addition, prefrontal areas having to do with motion, and in the end, some orbital frontal areas having to do with reward and the experience of having done it right. Okay. Now, yeah, I think I'll just say simply that in the last few years, my wife and I decided to endow a chair in the University of California at Los Angeles. It is the Joaquin Fuster Cognitive Neuroscience Chair of Center. And the first tenant is a woman, an exceptional woman, really an enormous asset to UCLA, who is an expert in imaging, particularly in cognitive neuroscience in humans. At the same time, I designed a set of laboratories to continue my monkey work. Yes, in the hands now of the director, who is Michelle Basso, a professor from the University of Wisconsin. Both of them have their offices in this new building. The monkey part I designed, and I think I said enough, so I'll end up with those critical bases of science, of good science, and education of young people in science. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you, Joaquin. That's fantastic. And we are moving now to the discussion. There's going to be a panel discussion titled The Keys of Innovation, Technology Transfer from University to Industry, and there's going to be a moderator who is Pinar Manchon. And she's director of Intelligent Digital Assistance and Voice at Intel. And you're here. Sorry, I wasn't looking for you. And I let you take over. Perhaps you introduce the.
Excuse me?
You can introduce the.
Yes. So, good evening. I am Pilar Manchon, and it's a pleasure and an honor to be here. We have a wonderful panel of expert scientists in really humbling people here that I invite you please to come along and sit. And I'm just going to basically say their names and what they're doing, and I'm going to let them introduce themselves, because I think that I wouldn't be able to do justice to their amazing curricula. So just starting here, we have Oscar Segurado, Director of Medical Affairs Consulting, Professor of Immunology at the University of León.
Thank you so much. It's a real pleasure to be here with you. I'm a physician, I'm a scientist, and I'm a biotechnologist. My real passion is immunology, and I've been working in immunotherapies and immunodiagnostics, but let me tell you how everything started. It started with a work that I did on a disease that is very related to what Joaquin Fuster just mentioned, and this was Creutzfeldt-Jakob disease. It's a very serious neurological disorder where it looks like an infectious disease, but there is no immune response. So that's why I even tried to have thought about psychiatry, but I moved into neurology, and from there to neuroimmunology. I also worked for the University of León for a few months. I'm in leave with that university, and in the past 20 years, I've been with a number of big pharma biotechs working again in immunotherapy and immunodiagnostics.
So next we have a non-working microphone. And Professor, it's okay, you just keep it, I can push my voice up. Professor Eva Nogales, Professor of Biochemistry and Molecular Biology of the Howard Hughes Medical Institute Investigator on UC Berkeley. And I must say, because I don't know what she's going to say, that she just was invited and elected to the National Academy of Sciences, which is, you know, extremely special. And she's also been awarded recently the Society's Dorothy Crowfoot Hodgkin Award. Now you can do this.
Thank you. So I just want to say that I started doing science, well, learning about science in Madrid at the Universidad Autónoma, and where I got a degree in physics, and almost decided to continue working in physics, but almost by accident. And I think this is something that I want to emphasize, that accidents or diversions in your lives, taking opportunities when they come, is very, very critical. And I don't know that it was not already covered by, in a way, by the presentation that you had before. But in any case, I move into biophysics and to the study of macromolecular complexes, proteins, DNA, RNA, at a time when really molecular biology was taking off, and it has been a real ride and fantastic. I did my PhD in England, actually with Joan Bordas, a native of Andorra, who happened to be the director of the synchrotron radiation source in England. And then I came to Berkeley, to the Lawrence Berkeley National Lab, where I had the opportunity to work with someone fantastic, Ken Downing. We did work that were considered revolutionary at the time, and that allowed me to get a position at UC Berkeley, where I've been ever since. And I look forward to talk to you more about my experience as a scientist in this country.
So next we have Guayente San Martin, Worldwide Commercial Desktop Vice President and GM at HP.
So my name is Guayente. Hello. Yeah, it's working.
Yeah.
And as you said, like, I work for Hewlett Packard. I don't have this magnificent background on PhD and science that the professor have, but I can say that I work in HP managing business, and I work in the art of product marketing. So, like, usually comes from the business schools, but I do come from a telecommunication engineer, and I have been driving several transformations in HP, so I would love to share like my experience at an enterprise, you know, transforming through innovation.
Next we have Jordine Trias, who is president at JTPS, which is an incubator for new startups.
Well, thank you. I do come from the academic world also. Interestingly, I really enjoy the woodpeckers. My first paper was on birds. That, you know, a long time ago. Really, my job here, what I've been doing the last 30 years, or no, 25 years or so, is moving, after I moved from the academic world to the biotech, is be involved in projects to discover and develop drugs. So far, I do have three in the market, two phase threes, two additional in phase three right now. All of these in approximately five different companies, four of which went IPO. One was acquired by Pfizer, the other by Johnson & Johnson. I'm right now in my next round of companies. I worked a lot with universities, either licensing in or paying them to do the work that I needed in the lab. Right now, I'm working with two universities in Barcelona, also University in Singapore, and here Harvard and a few others for an Emory, I forgot that one, for different projects. I think really it's fascinating. I've had my share of dealings with the technology transfers and the professors or postdocs or who have invented the technologies. And I think that actually it's a great opportunity, both giving work to the universities and getting, you know, ideas and concepts from the universities, putting them into a package, finding resources, moving it forward, and at the end of the day, everyone wins. There are new drugs for patients, and everyone that is involved in the project gets something, whether publications for the scientists, money for the investors, a great experience so far.
And last but not least, Professor Pablo Villoslada, adjunct professor of the Department of Neurology at UCSF and senior researcher at IEDBOPS, and founder and scientist advisor of Behavioural.
Okay, thank you. I'm a physician, neurologist by training. I have been working in research, in the, especially in the field of MS. I'm mainly a practitioner of innovation and translational research. With my friend and partner, Albert Zamora, we found Behavioural. It's a company that started in Barcelona. We have moved here 1 year ago to Silicon Valley, and there we are developing new drugs for multiple sclerosis and other neurological diseases. Also, I'm, as I say, developing medical devices for imaging the retina, or we have licensed recently a software for analyzing the brain structure, meaning that we try to practice at, this translation from the academy there in Barcelona, here at the University of California, San Francisco. I'm following the inspiration of the two Joaquins here. Joaquin Trier is helping me a lot in innovation. Joaquin Fuster is an inspiration always in cognitive science.
Well, thank you for your introductions. I don't think I would have been able to do justice to all those curricula. And let's go directly to the conversation. I'd like for you to discuss, what do you think the difference from the innovation point of view in industry and academia is today? How do you focus on innovation? How is that different?
Well, I'll give you my very personal opinion.
Please.
So, I think, well, first, usually innovation that becomes something of value, meaning you can put together a company and move the project forward, which is what I do, really doesn't change that much whether it's a university or a company. I think the major differences are in the size of the organization. It's very difficult to innovate, for example, in a larger structure because we are fighting a bureaucracy, and it's very difficult to change. You know, you come up with a new idea, it's difficult to implement. In a small company, it's way easier, unless you do have enough resources. For example, if you are a full professor with plenty of grants, you have the resources to try new things. That's very difficult in a big company, it's way easier in a small company. If you look at, and I'm talking now about pharmaceuticals and biotech, innovation mostly comes from small companies when it comes to drugs. When it comes to new concepts and paradigms, often it comes from the university, but they rarely come from big pharmaceutical companies. What they do is they buy innovation. So they buy whoever brought the concept to phase two, and then they acquire. Most, if you look at the pipeline of current companies, of the big companies, it's bought out. And what you see is a bunch of smaller companies that are wishing that they're going to be bought out at the right time. Innovation from university, what I've seen usually is it's difficult to get something very specific as a drug, but they're great at defining a field where you can't find a drug, for example. So defining a new, disease node, giving you the parameters that you need to discover the new drug, but not the new drug itself. That's rare. It happens, but it's really rare.
So you would say that bureaucracy is basically what's stopping larger corporations from being innovative?
Well, larger structure, it's not only bureaucracy. No one in a big company gets rewarded because discovered something, because they're you know, from the moment you discover something, it reaches the market and it's useful. In a big company, that's 12, 15 years. So people have been promoted many times and forgot what they started at the end of this period.
There are a lot of HP people here.
As I said, No. As I said, I'll give you my very personal opinion.
I work for Intel.
but I have this, for me, because pharmaceutical companies, they are great once you have already discovered something. You have to do a large clinical study. Then they're the best. And you have to sell a product. They know how to sell products.
Anybody else has a point of view?
I can. Again, no, I do come from a different angle. In Hewlett-Packard, today, you know, like, we have like three types of innovation, or one that are what we call wave one, that is product related, and second are more like when we create new categories of products, and third, what are technology. And we are investing, you know, close to $3 billion every year, and there is a lot of innovation that is being launched every year, no? And again, no, there are different industries have different life cycles. I agree, however, you know, working, I have been, and that's the personal opinion, that there are several challenges, you know, in a big corporation to move forward when you need to do a change in a corporation. You know, like when a company like HP has been used to sell printers, you know, in the past based on DPIs and number of colors, and suddenly you have to move to a user experience, you know, and a printer that is easy to use, the concept is completely different and takes a while, I agree, but there is a lot of innovation happening still.
I agree really with what was said before concerning the pipeline that is needed to really get innovation all the way from science discovery to product. I think there has to be an academy layer of completely new science. Is for you guys, for example, would be the discovery of semiconductors. That was not done at a company. That was done at Bell Labs, done by people that were pure physicists doing theory and experimental work, or something very, very scientific without necessarily knowing that this was going to ultimately revolutionize, you know, turned up into the iPhone or something. So I think innovation at the design level comes from asking new questions and developing the methods to answer them. It's just, it comes from wanting to know nature, not necessarily from wanting to change it, which is more what engineers will do, or to manipulate it into something that is useful for humans, which again will be something that biotech, for example, is doing to our health. So the innovation at the scientific level has to come from a passion to answer, to identify important questions and to pursue them, and in the process develop the methodology that is required, maybe building a, you know, the cage for the monkeys that you heard before. So both understanding what was an important question and how to go and solve it was a beautiful example that we had from Ignacio. That's where the innovation comes, which is distinct from you know, coming with a brilliant idea that people are gonna want to buy. Is a different perspective.
So that brings me to actually the discussion about what is the real difference between innovation and research and development? Because we go back and forth there, and you're just talking about, you know, the labs and their hardcore research that's happening there that resulted in innovation in different spaces, but the methodology of innovation and research and development are different. So where would you draw that line? How would you do that different?
Okay, so I think that when we talk about innovation and R&D, we should also see the similarities between what is happening in academia and what is happening in the industry. And there are two aspects that are very clearly similar in both. One is people. There are people that are innovators, that are scientists, that are experts in certain areas, that spend time as scientists trying to find new ideas, new products, new business models. And there is also structure. It's very important that you also take into account the structure that is needed in academia, in universities, to make sure that there is an environment that is going to facilitate that these people are going to innovate. You have to make sure that there is, for instance, in universities, I'm sure there is here, in Stanford, in other places, an IP office in intellectual property that is also everything related to business development, helping also that people like what Professor Fuster told us, that there are mentors that help people move and get their ideas across. The same also applies to industry. So it's very important that in the industry there are also structures that facilitate the communication with academia. So just giving you an example of what happened to me when I was at the Institute of Immunology in Munich. I was working there in an environment where the leader of the of that university was already thinking about industry. He even created a startup there. It was a company called Micromed that was acquired by Amgen for $1.2 billion a few years ago. And what happened? That I also felt kind of this environment, and I was thinking about how I could innovate in one way or another. What happened is that I was pushed in some way to the industry. So that again is what I'm trying to say. It's very important that you have this environment in academia, in industry, that you also have people that are going to use this environment to move on.
I would like to explain my experience in this sense. At the academia is a great, you have a lot of freedom in order to generate ideas. And just give me an example. We invite some just ago a great professor from Imperial College, Martin Raff. He's a great neurologist. And he said, all my students start to present their ideas. And at the end he said, oh, all your ideas are great. You are brilliant scientists. But 99% of them are going to be wrong. Meaning that you can spend all your life pursuing your idea and at the end discover that it's wrong, or just try to kill your idea at the beginning and if this survive, let's just go ahead after that. Okay, this is a research, this is discovery at the academia level. You know, it's where the ideas flourish. But after that, you need to proceed to this cycle. It's the cycle of innovation, from research to innovation, and translate one idea to a real product. To some degree, it's you take money, you spend money, create knowledge, this is research, and then you take knowledge and produce money with that, this innovation. And in this sense is where there is differences in the culture of both type of organizations. Now we are trying to smooth, there are some places that are great in order to do that. Here is one of the samples. In Spain, it takes a lot. People that have tried to do their knows what we are talking about. And also at the personal level, my experience is that there are two types maybe of people doing innovation from the academy to the industry. The very young, meaning engineers just finishing maybe the PhD and start creating a new startup. And this is a culture that we have in Spain. People expect somebody in the 20s and 30s and paying nothing and working a lot. But in my case, I start maybe a little bit later. And in this case, you need somebody with the expertise, meaning you have the expertise in science and research, but it is somebody with a great expertise in the thing I don't really like, business, finances, marketing, and he loves, in this case, I'm talking about him, my colleague, Albert Zamora, but in other experience this happened, meaning you need to have somebody, you need to create a team. There are several keys of success in terms of innovation. One is find the best people with a great expertise. This translation is what is required in the move from academia to industry.
Just one comment on when you say innovation and MSD and R&D, and I think that for me innovation is not only when there is a new technology that comes into the market or discovery of something. For me, innovation is when you do something different, and it could be something that you do in the product that maybe is putting different technologies that already all of them existed but give you an experience, you know, that you have never had before. Or is innovation in the process on how you are creating something, or is innovation on how you are selling, or is innovation in which channels are you using to sell. So I think that innovation is not just like a phase or a part or one thing. Innovation is a value of everything that we're doing, you know, even in our personal or professional lives.
I think innovation is creativity with a practical purpose.
Yeah.
That where there's some novelty that comes about. But there's one thing that I want to say. I don't know if it's exactly off target, but I don't want this to go unsaid in a meeting like this with some of the people that are here today, which is that it's not a question of just because someone is innovative and has great ideas, it doesn't mean that this person is going to succeed immediately or even succeed. So there has to be always huge investment and risk-taking, and when, you know, it's a question of the impact of what you're going to do. The larger it is, the more the risk that it's not going to work. And as a society, we have to invest in risk-taking, knowing that 95% of the time is not necessarily going to lead to immediate success. And in many cases, it has to be with an open mind that in many cases, you know, problems, major problems are solved. This is the scientist speaking. By finding the opportunity out of creating new knowledge. I think the idea of how academia and biotech are integrated, to me, is my favorite one. It's exactly what you were saying. someone makes a discovery in some cellular pathway, and then someone in biotech realizes that this is now an opportunity to cure a disease in a particular way. But if that discovery on a certain pathway had not been discovered just out of, you know, pure curiosity, that opportunity would not have come. So every little piece on this chain is required, and every piece requires innovation, risk-taking, and the possibility of failure. And this is the most important thing about being an innovator. You have to not fear failure. You have to embrace it. If you don't fail, you're not doing anything that is worth trying, or otherwise someone has done it before you. So
I'm going to piggyback on that idea and just go on addressing questions. This is a very Spanish forum. What are the differences between the Silicon Valley and Spain?
Actually, well, the weather is the same, frankly. now we're just with the differences. Well, definitely there's a culture of risk taking. But here, what is rewarded is success. No one rewards failure. All right, not even here. So when people say, well, you can go back and all that, yeah, it's a lot of work. Failure is not a plus. I've heard many times that it's like a medal you have. No, it's not. Failure is failure. Now, if you fail, you can come back, that's true. Success is what drives Silicon Valley, it's not failure. Now, trying, as you pointed out, is what goes behind the success and the failures. What you have to do is really do a good risk analysis. Risk analysis doesn't mean you can't foresee what is going to happen, but you can either try to solve a problem that is very difficult, then you're probably going to fail, or solve a problem that is unknown. Then the odds of success are way higher. And that goes against the way people think in Europe. It's not Spain, it's the rest of the world. People try to take a path that has already been beaten.
But you know, so you have to don't try to do it. The fact that here failure is in your favor. So if you have two people, one that has already failed and one that has never tried, you go for the one that has already failed.
Neither one.
Already has the experience.
I go for the one who succeeded, and that's
and you're the
Valley.
Venture investor.
No, I'm not. This is Silicon Valley. There are many ways of explaining failure. That's true. You can flip it. But no one bets on failure. Forget that.
No, but it's positive experience.
Yeah.
Well,
you know, when the light bulb was invented, what was that? I just found 2,000 ways of not doing the light bulb.
But
right?
I don't call that failure.
It was
1999. I think the difference here between failure and success is perseverance, I think.
Well,
and also the fact that
and
yes,
confidence.
They end up being people that
funding.
Lose.
But if the many times you try to do something doesn't work, you call this failure, you're out.
All marketing.
No, but that's actually a distinction very important. Here you reward success. Success can. I'm not saying success is one time bad. I've never said that. You may have to try 99 times. To me, there are no 99 failures at all. So you have to change the way you think if you want to.
Well, I tell my son every day that you don't fail and then you stop trying. So I'm already bought into that idea.
Right.
But in order to continue trying, we need support.
Yes.
And that's where sponsorship comes in, and that's where funding comes in, and venture capital.
Okay, but if we come back to the original question, this. Why innovation is maybe not taking so much force in Spain? There's plenty of innovators. What is missing there is missing, of course, the money. Is missing the talent. Is missing the personal, the human resources in the sense of the labor force, and also is the global thinking. Maybe you know when people start companies in Spain and they pretend to make the sales in Spain, they do that.
Did you say they were missing the talent?
Yeah.
I hear
you're
right.
No. Yeah. Okay. Many times. What?
You're not gonna get away with that.
No. This is what Joaquin is saying. Okay. Here, you have people that have tried or have created three or four companies in the past. They have expertise. They they know how to solve problems, because at the end, as professionals, as you're saying, you're going to have many, many difficulties in the middle, and you need to solve and find a way. You know, it's not a, like a big corporation that you have an idea from the beginning and you just pursue it. You are always looking for the way. But here is you have this bench of people with expertise in finances, but specifically in the sector of innovation, in, for example, in my case, in biotech, or lawyers that know about that. You know, this is and the reason of that is because here everybody is coming from all around the world. Meaning, there's plenty of people from India, from China, from wherever. I mean, this is making a difference. But especially also thinking global. And in Spain, we're quite a little bit close, and maybe we think a little bit about Europe and not further than that. And here everybody's thinking about Asia, India, Latin America, whatever.
And this would you not say that that's somewhat related to education and the level of ambition and self-confidence that we have in our ranks?
It's just, no, it's not the level of ambition, it's an attitude, it's not having fear. Meaning, it looks like very pretentious, meaning I'm going to develop the new Google. If you say that in Madrid or in Barcelona. Yep. But here is, people believe that. Look for that and fight for that. Of course, for 100 of them that are going to try, they're going to fail 99, but maybe one is creating not Google, another thing completely new, because it's like in MBAs that they explain these histories about the success of big companies. It's impossible to reproduce a previous success. You need to create something completely new. And this is why VC doesn't make any sense. There is not money with risk. Money is afraid of risk. But here, at least, we have re-educated these people, and they are putting some money on that.
Yeah, I think that one of the reasons Spain is not where it could be, considering the amount of talent that we have, and we can see that here, in Spain, is because probably in Spain, like in many other countries where you live so well, where you have a fantastic type of weather, where you have great food, where you have the sun, the people, the environment, is that the people are not really taking risks and leaving the country and going somewhere else. Sometimes people even are afraid to go to Madrid. I'm originally from Salamanca. When I heard also Professor Fuster talking about taking a boat in his maybe his 20s, it reminds me also my grandfather that went to Cuba when he was 16, and it's something that we cannot even imagine. I know that many of us have been coming over here, but when I think the percentage of the Spaniards that come to California, when you compare that with percentage of people from Vietnam or many other countries in East Asia, or even Africa, I think that there is something that we need to do that is not happening in Spain. And there are many people that are very innovating, very innovators, creative, and that should change in some way.
Just wanted to mention very quickly something that you said, that you guys would have experience already if you lived in the States for a while, and it's even more extreme, I think, in California. And is what you said about the kids are being taught, and I was not taught like that, and it was some years ago, so maybe this has been changed in Spain. They have to be unique. Which we in Spain will say, es un raro, es un rarito. No, here, being unique is a big plus. So no one wants to look like anyone else. They want to be distinct, they want to have their own edge. And the other thing is, you have to see the American kids learning to play baseball, where they're going and they cannot hit the ball. And the parents are not going, oh God, hit it now already. They're going, good try. Good try. You're gonna succeed. It's just that's what is builds self-confidence on yourself, on your own perspective of going your own way, and that's helped. I mean, it's just very, very basic. It's this. There are many other things that have to do with then having the infrastructure and the historical capacity to embrace and commercialize, and you know. But the way kids are raised here are. Believing in themselves and believing that it's important to be unique. So that's
they're already innovating with themselves in a way, right?
That is a fantastic comment. I'd like to also talk about innovating at different stages of your life, your career, innovating in your 20s, in your 30s, in your 40s, in your 80s, in your 200s.
Age makes no difference. That's the only thing I have to say.
Really?
Yeah.
Is that because it's a vocation, because it's training,
because
it's
creative
environment?
It's in your brain. You keep always thinking, what's new here, what could be new, what just come natural.
I'm sorry to insist, but don't you think the amount of knowledge, training, and experience that you have has an impact on the way you innovate,
yeah,
and the way you see innovation? Because when you, I can only talk about myself, and I'm going to just take over a little bit here. But I remember when I was younger, like yesterday, the way I thought about innovation was more about something that you need to do in order to get something else. But it was not methodological. It was more of a kind of wild brute force kind of way, right? You're young, you're strong, you just want to get things done and just go for it, right? And even if you don't know how, you just get things done.
Well,
as
you do mistakes more often, but
you do,
innovate,
but it's different.
But innovate, yeah, right?
It's different. Then you evolve.
Well, the result of innovation is different, but the way you innovate is identical. I know, you know, I can assess better the risk of that innovation moving forward now than 30 years ago, but that's it.
But
I think in my case, honestly, and I'm also very young, in my 20s still, why do you laugh? Anyway, but I think the big change is, I think the spirit does not change. So I think either you have this spirit or you don't. But what I have learned, you know, like moving across different business and geographies is precisely the methodology. So there are different ones. One thing I have learned is that there are no methodology that is perfect. The only perfect one is the one that your organization from bottom to top buys in, you know, and what to do, you know, like how to start, like the customer interaction, you know, with the innovation is one thing that how we were doing it 20 years ago, at least, you know, like in my organization, with ethnographic research and customer, the participation is completely different in the process. So I think there is, at least on how we innovate, is different. The value probably is not. And there is this art, you know, that either you have it or you don't. But the rest, I really think there is big changes.
So I really think that there is an evolutionary perspective to innovation, and it indeed changes over time. And I can give you an example about my experience. When I was younger, I was focusing on something very specific, very tangible. So you are working, when you're young, you want to make sure that you develop a product, something that you can touch, that you can feel. When you start getting over time, and when you start getting older, you start seeing things more into a context. So you innovate, and this is very much to what you, Vajente, were saying, you're thinking more in perspective, so of things that you're doing and you've been doing over time, like for instance business models. So how you develop something that is not just again something very specific, but something that can be used in different contexts. Let me give you an example. In the past 4 days, I was attending the American Society of Clinical Oncology in Chicago, and I was amazed because they were talking about something that I was working 25 years ago, which is immunotherapy. So trying to harness the power of your immune system to kill cells. And this is an area where I work very specifically in the same Institute of Immunology I mentioned before on how these white blood cells, lymphocytes, were able to kill cells. We were not able to get anywhere because they were there together with the, practically touching the tumor cells, but they were not killing them. In the past few years, there has been something which is called gatekeepers or checkpoints checkpoints that now the entire industry, the entire biotech and academia are working on. And now what you see is that in medicine, everything is going to change in terms of cancer care. From what we were doing before, which were targeted therapies, we are now going to move into personalized medicine, where we are going to create a very specific therapy for each individual. That's context. So now we will need to figure out how we put together diagnostics, therapies, everything together. And there is innovation that is already happening, and where academia and industry need to work together to ensure that we get in the right place in terms of cancer care.
Just what I was thinking more about, another thing that I have changed, you know, over the years is, at least in a company, you know, we don't do anything by ourselves. So we always talk, we never say I, you know. And in this way, it's very important, the team that you put together in order to innovate, you know, and or in order to create a new category or a new feature in a new product. And this is one thing that if you look at who we were hiring, you know, like 20 years ago to do product marketing or new product creation, were mainly either, the majority were engineers, you know, I'm an engineer too, but then we were adding some people from business. But really today, if you look at who are the best ones, you know, I'm just looking at designers, you know, that are designers because they can imagine, you know, what a new product could be more than anything. So just even at the group of people and how you hire and what you look for the people is completely different when creating innovation. And this, you know, 20 years ago, I was too naive to see.
Maybe I can add from the perspective of neurology. Maybe I could agree with Joaquin. We have the wrong perspective that young people are highly innovative, which is not true. When they are teenagers, they are start to explore new risk, and we believe that is innovation, but it's not true. It's just risk searching, seeking. Innovators is a trait that you have. I think a great book for that, which is contained a checklist, is the Black Book of Entrepreneurs from Trias. Meaning that you can check whether you have this profile or not, and if you have it, just pursue it. It's the only thing that you can do it and enjoy, because it's your fate. Maybe what is changing is the way in which you innovate. When you are young, you are very passionate and make many mistakes, and when you are more mature, you are able to add your experience. Also, you know, you start to share, don't behave so secrets, or try to recruit the right team. Also explore a new, don't be so focused, explore new avenues, because then to keep innovating, but the activity is the same.
Okay, fair enough. I can beg to disagree, but we'll leave it at that. So from the industry perspective, because most of the people in the panel are focused on industry, how much do you think it's necessary to invest in innovation? From the large company perspective, there are billions of dollars being invested in research and development and innovation. From a small startup perspective, is a very different kind of environment. So you need to innovate or die. But how much of your funding do you dedicate to that?
Usually the cost of innovation in the startups I've been involved are about 20-30% of equivalent in the large corporation. And you're just and the big advantage is we can't take decisions, and a big corporation just can't. It's difficult. And again, the model is pharmaceutical companies. It's just different. They are not. We are not smarter than them. Absolutely not. In big pharmaceutical companies, often research is constrained rather than driven by what they call the target product profile. So if you define a set of properties and say, okay, we'll find something that has all that, well, you'll never find it, because the probability of finding one property plus the other, plus the other, plus the other, it goes to zero. A small company, you find something that is interesting. Okay, well then, instead of following the TPP, you're going to follow something else that actually aligns well with the properties of that compound. Well, then you have found something that would have been discarded in the big company. So that flexibility first lowers the cost, and you go way faster, which lowers the cost again. And we don't have small companies also the rich resources in terms of brain power that big companies have. But you don't need it. I don't need a crystallographer to find out that a methyl group versus a propyl group in that molecule makes the difference. Excuse me? Yeah. Minor modification, you don't need fancy technology. You just call someone in China and make me these two compounds, they're cheap, test it, done.
Well, I've just been advised that we only have 5 minutes left,
right,
and I didn't want to miss the opportunity to actually ask each of you to provide a memorable sentence, paragraph, statement that you would like for this audience to remember. And Eva promised that she didn't have one, she was going to dance for us, so.
Sevillanas.
Eva, you're first.
Absolutely not.
Let's start
you
with
have
the gentleman on the other side. Let's give her some time to think.
Okay, what I will say with this great forum of people with this great expertise, and this is one of the missions that in ECUSA we are trying to develop, is just start to networking, exchange ideas. What we dream is that the engineers start to talk with the biologists and with the physicians and start to generate new ideas, new projects that we can be developed here or can be back to Spain. 99% of them are going to fail, but maybe one is going to succeed. Good luck.
I must say that you're very, very positive in everything that you have stated.
Well, I only want to say one thing, actually specifically to the Spanish crowd. You know, thanks to this crisis, I've never seen so many good projects in my life coming from Spain. They're competitive, they're damn good. And just follow on that.
Keep the braces.
Yeah.
For me, one thing that at least I have personally learned in this journey for innovation is to really hire, for those that are managing, product marketing or business strategy, whatever you call it in your company. I think this the people that you hire are people that can really imagine what the future will be. And they cannot imagine, don't hire them. And people that cannot dream, don't hire them. Don't hire just engineers or computer science, or it's just the diversity, of people coming from different backgrounds, from science, from business, from engineer, from nothing to do like ethnographics. It's really like the teams that can succeed and scale innovation, over years and over different businesses.
I would say keep on learning, keep your eyes open for opportunities, follow your ideas, and take some measured risks if you really want to have an impact. Not 100% of the people have to be the innovator that makes the difference, but if you want to be one, you have to not be scared of failure. Pursue success, but you can't pursue success if you're afraid.
So in line with cognitive neuroscience and everything that we saw today, I would recommend that if you really want to unleash the power of creativity inside yourself, you have to control your monkey mind. by that I mean the fact that you're going to have a number of thoughts the entire day. You're going to be distracted by email, text, people, and whatever. Try to really select and filter all that so that you really go and recognize those good thoughts and creative ones.
Well, I'm going to add one last thought. I believe that we do have the talent in Spain and in very many other areas of the world. I think that we have very many challenges to overcome, but here there is an amazing amount of IQ. I don't know what the concentration per square inch is, but it's pretty high. And I would encourage each and every one of you not only to embrace innovation and do whatever it takes and stay hungry, but encourage those around you to do the same and create a domino effect in the people around you. And last, I'd like to thank all the sponsors, the government of Spain, the Chamber of Commerce,
ECUSA.
I forgot the name, sorry. And of course, this wonderful panelist. Please give them a hand.